Hello. Yeah. Thank you all so much for coming. I'd like to welcome you to our panel discussion, a conversation about the ethics of climate change research. My name is Joseph Mazor. I am a postdoc at the Center for Ethics and Society. I will introduce my fellow panelists in a second, but I first wanted to say a few words about this panel. This is not a panel about whether climate change is actually happening, nor is it a panel about whether climate change is anthropogenic. We're not going to be addressing those questions here. Nor is it a question about a panel about what we should do about climate change. Rather, it's a panel about the philosophical issues that arise when conducting climate change research and communicating it with the public, which are a set of issues that I think are not discussed often enough. Really, we're going to be addressing three major issues in the course of the discussion. The first is, what is the proper relationship between climate change research and values and ideology? The second is, how should we minimize the various distorting effects that can potentially undermine the integrity of climate change research? And the third is, how should climate change research be discussed in the public sphere? Why climate change research? Many of these questions apply to other types of climate of science more generally. However, climate change research is particularly prominent, particularly important, and particularly subject of controversy in the public sphere. With that, I'd like to introduce my fellow panelists. Here is Noah Diffenbaugh. He is an assistant professor in the School of Earth Sciences and the Woods Institute for the Environment at Stanford. His research interests are centered on the dynamics of an impact of climate variability and change, including the role of humans as a coupled component of the climate system. He was a contributor to the US Climate Change Science Program SSM in 2008. He is an editor of Geophysical Research Letters and a lead author for the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change Research, the IPCC. Naomi Oreskes is a professor of history and science studies at the University of California, San Diego, and an adjunct professor of geosciences at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, and an internationally renowned historian of science and author. She is an author of many works, including The Rejection of Continental Drift, Theory and Methods in American Earth Science, and most recently, The Merchants of Doubt, How a Handful of Scientists Obscured the Truth on Issues from Tobacco Smoke to Global Warming in 2000, and that came out in 2010. I'm very grateful that you both could join us for this conversation. And as I said, my name is Joseph Mazor. I'm a postdoc at the Center for Ethics and Society, and my interests are in environmental ethics. Okay, with that, I'd like to just start with our discussion. A couple words about the format. So we'll be talking for about 45 to 50 minutes, and then we'll be opening up the question and that question and answer to the audience, and then I'll briefly conclude with some remarks at the very end. Okay. So I'd like to start with a couple of quotes. Basically, I'd like to start with the question of the proper relationship between values and ideology in climate science. So here's a quote from Richard Linson from MIT. He's a meteorological scientist from MIT, talking about his theory about the effects of cloud. What he says is, if I'm right about the effects, we'll have saved money by avoiding measures to limit emissions. If I'm wrong, we'll know it in 50 years and can do something about it. Then I'd also like to give a quote from James Hansen, who directs the NASA Goddard Institute for Space Studies and is the author of Storms of My Grandchildren. This is from an opinion piece recently, May 9th, in the New York Times. He writes, "The science of the situation is clear. It's time for the politics to follow. Every major national science academy in the world has reported that global warming is real, caused mostly by humans, and requires urgent action. The cost of acting goes far higher the longer we wait. We can't wait any longer to avoid the worst and be judged immoral by coming generations." And so my first question and I'll start with Naomi, is should scientists engage in policy advocacy? And if so, under what circumstances? And then I'll turn it over to Noah.
Yeah. Well, thanks. Thanks for inviting me here. It's nice to be here. I see the audience is laughing already after Richard Linson's comments. You know, I think this is a really complicated issue. Both Linson and Hansen have correctly identified that climate change is an issue with a large moral dimension. And there's no real getting around that. And you can't I don't think it works to pretend that it's not there, because it is there, and because when we say things about the science, it automatically implicates us in a mode which implies that because the climate is changing and because it's changing because of human activities, the implication of that is that therefore humans have some kind of responsibility and therefore perhaps need to do something about it. So I think the moral dimension is intrinsic and doesn't go away by pretending it's not there. But at the same time, it's obviously really fraught territory because many scientists are really not in a good position to speak to the moral and ethical dimensions. They're not in a good position to speak to the policy options because they have no training and expertise in those domains. So I do think there's a kind of fine line that scientists need to walk. I think that it's important for scientists to be clear about what they think the implications of their work are because they're the only ones who can do that. I mean, it's not just with climate change, it's with a lot of other things. If you think about, say, stratospheric ozone depletion, which is something I've written about, we wouldn't know there was ozone depletion if it weren't for scientists, right? All of us just living our lives, walking around, we didn't have any way to know that a hole in the ozone layer was developing. It took scientists to point that out, and we also didn't have any way to know why it mattered because most of us didn't know that the ozone layer protected us from harmful UV radiation. So it took scientists to say that too. So there was a dimension of the problem that had policy implications that we needed scientists to point out. And no one but scientists could do that. Yet at the same time, once we get to the point of discussing, well, therefore, is the right solution a complete ban on CFCs, a heavy taxation system, emissions trading, you know, what are the policy instruments that will be most effective? Well, at that point, you're moving into a different domain of expertise. So I think there it's very important that if scientists want the world to respect their expertise on the technical side, scientists have to recognize other people's policy, ethical, moral, economic expertise on that side. So in a way, it's a matter of, you know, being clear about where your own expertise begins and ends, and then respecting the expertise of colleagues in the adjacent relevant fields.
No.
Well, I certainly agree with that. Also, I'd like to echo Naomi's thanks for inviting us and having the panel. Actually, before I answer the question directly, I read an op-ed in the last year or two stating that all political candidates should wear the logos of the sponsors, much like NASCAR drivers wear the logos of all their sponsors on their suits. And this is more or less been suggested about climate scientists as well. So I thought this morning I would print out all the logos of the all the funding agencies from whom I have received grants, but I didn't quite get around to it. But I'm happy to declare them at whatever time is appropriate. But I think that this gets, in some sense, to the heart of the specific question, also the general topic. And I can only speak for myself. And the line that I'm comfortable walking. My research is, as was said in the introduction, is on trying to understand how the climate system works, trying to understand what the variations and changes in the climate system mean for people and how what our activities affect the climate system as well. So it's a lot of my work and my group's work is right at the heart of what makes it into the kind of policy discussions that we're being asked about. And I don't want to extrapolate from myself to every other climate scientist, but I will say that I'm not comfortable being engaged in policy advocacy. And that being said, much of my group's work is very policy relevant to the point that we publish peer-reviewed papers that specifically ask scientific questions about policy options. So I think there's an important distinction there, and I'm happy to discuss the details of it. But that's my brief answer.
Great. So if scientists are not necessarily going to be policy advocates, I guess the next question is, what role do values play in the research more generally, besides being specifically policy advocates? So I'd like to read a couple of quotes from the policy summary of the let me get the exact citation. This is from the Summary for Policymakers in Climate Change 2007, Impacts, Adaptation, and Vulnerability, Contributions of Working Group 2 to the Fourth Assessment Report on the of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So the first quote is, adaptation alone is not expected to cope with all the projected effects of climate change, and especially not over the long term, as most impacts increase in magnitude. And the second quote is, studies in temperate areas have shown that climate change is projected to bring some benefits, such as fewer deaths from cold exposure. Overall, it is expected that these benefits will be outweighed by the negative health effects of rising temperatures worldwide, especially in developing countries. And the question that I wanted to raise with these two quotes is what role should values have in scientific work? And should we strive to have a science that's completely value-free? And I'll start with Noah on this question.
So what should we strive to have a science that's completely value-free? Well, I guess I think it's important that we as scientists are clear about where our statements are evidence-based, and at the least that we're clear about what statements are evidence-based and what statements are value judgments. I think the previous question, someone's answer to your previous question could be yes, scientists should engage in policy advocacy. And if that's the case, then I do think that it's important that that in that communication it's clearly stated what is evidence and scientific evidence based on the scientific method and what is a value judgment. I'm not sure the quote that you read from Professor Hansen, there is a value statement in there, and that so essentially the quote was that the climate is changing, that humans are the primary cause of observed climate changes, certainly at the, and I'll add certainly at the global scale, and that if something about it, that something needs to be done. I don't want to butcher the quote too badly, but I mean the third part of that in my mind is a value. That's a value statement, and I don't know the statements of the National Academies well enough that that he's referencing there, but it doesn't. I'm interested to hear more from Naomi about this connection between if there's evidence that humans are altering the climate system, that therefore, if I've identified that connection, that therefore I am bound to argue that something must be done. So I think at the very least we need to be very clear about where that boundary is in our statements.
Yeah, I don't think that one is logically bound into that position, but I do think that implicitly that's the position that the IPCC has taken by virtue of even creating the IPCC in the first place, that the implication, and it's not just implied, I mean, it's overt, and if you read, say, some of the things that Bert Bolin and other people were writing in the 1980s about why the IPCC was needed, if scientists hadn't thought that this wasn't a problem about which something might need to be done, they would have not felt the need to create the IPCC. They would have simply published their articles in peer-reviewed journals as they would do any science. The whole reason why an assessment process gets created for ozone or acid rain or climate change or vaccines, one of the earliest royal commissions in the history of science was the Royal Commission on the Efficacy of the Smallpox Vaccine. Right? Why are these special commissions and assessments created? It's because the science has policy implications. And it's the recognition of that policy implication that causes the creation of this sort of additional structure. And that's where it's, the IPCC, to my mind, is a hybrid organization. It's composed of scientists who do science for a living, but they're also presenting that science in a different format than they would do if they were simply trying to get tenure or promotion, here at home at Stanford, right? And so it's that interesting hybrid that I think where some of these tough issues then start to get played out.
We'll have a chance to more back and forth later on. I just wanted to bring in Weber here just really quickly. In response, there are some scientists who believe that science can be value-free. And Weber writes in Science is a Vocation, I think, a quote. I mean, it's amazing that these topics are not new. I mean, these are age-old questions. Let me just get this what he writes. This is a great quote. It's worth waiting for. okay, so he asks in Science of Evocation, he says, you know, today no one speaks of science as free, today one speaks of science as free from presuppositions. Is there such a thing? And what he gives a bunch of answers, but one of them is no. Science presupposes that what is yielded by scientific analysis is worth being known. In this, obviously, are contained all of our problems, for this presupposition cannot be proved by scientific means. It can only be interpreted with reference to its ultimate meaning, which we must reject or accept according to our ultimate position towards life. And I guess you edit a journal. And I guess the question to you is, how do you decide what should go in the journal, right? I mean, you can obviously judge it on scientific merit, but in a sense, don't you also have to consider values in that decision of what's important, both in the journal and in terms of what you pursue in your own research?
Well, yeah, so I'm a editor for Geophysical Research Letters, which is published by the American Geophysical Union. So it's a society, scientific society. It's not a commercial journal. And you know, we have some values stated very clearly in our right on the website of what we're looking to publish, and you know, that's essentially that the science is correct, that it's that it's innovative and will immediately impact the work of others in the community, and therefore requires rapid publication. So we have a built-in value, and you know, I end up rejecting a lot of papers that, you know, the decision letter essentially is, you know, this appears to be scientifically correct, and on, you know, given our mission of publishing immediately impactful work, I encourage you to submit it somewhere else. I don't want to say we're an itch journal. We're one of the flagships for the AGU, but we do have that value built right in. But I think more broadly, there's, you know, as a reviewer, as an author, as someone who, you know, has graduate students that I'm responsible for mentoring. I think that there's certainly the fundamentally we want science to be correct, and we want it to be reproducible. We want it to be clear, and those are that's absolutely necessary. And then there become questions of you know, what does the community need to learn about most. Right now, and that creates priorities, whether it's what, you know, individual research priorities are, or how reviewers view the mission of a journal and the relevance of a manuscript, and likewise for editors.
Yeah, I mean, so this is a really interesting question. So my people, historians and philosophers of sociologists of science, have spilled a huge amount of ink over Weber, right? And there's enormous literature about this topic, and Robert Proctor in the history department here has written a whole book called Value-Free Science. So I think the question one wants to ask is, what is the ideal of value-free science supposed to be achieving anyway? Mm-hmm. And I think Noah hit the nail on the head a minute ago. You said we want the science to be correct. And I think that's the bottom line that everyone involved in the scientific enterprise would agree about. The goal is that the science should be right. We should find out true things about the natural world and come to understand the natural world in a deeper, more robust, more reliable way. Either because we want to do something with that knowledge or because we appreciate the world more just by knowing certain things about it. So then the question becomes, how do we get there? And for a long time, scientists believed that the success of scientific research inhered in the qualities, the moral qualities of the scientist. And in the 19th century, the whole notion of value-free science was really based on a highly individualistic concept of what it took to create good scientific knowledge. And it was summarized probably best by Claude Bernard, who wrote about what it was like to enter the laboratory door. And he says, when the scientist enters the laboratory door, he does two things. He puts on a white coat, but he also takes off something. And when he dons that white coat, he also sheds himself, his personality, his convictions, his beliefs, his values, his religious commitments. Okay, well, that's a nice idea, but the reality is that there isn't a shred of evidence in the history of science that supports that that's really a realistic picture of what actually happens. And rather, it's the opposite, that I would argue that what the history of science shows is that when you scratch the surface of science, any science in any discipline, even the most famous and fantastic scientists, famous people like Einstein or Schrodinger or Darwin or whoever it is you love and admire in science, you scratch the surface, you find all kinds of values. And one of my favorite examples of this is T.C. Chamberlain, who Leo Laporte knows about, who was the most famous geologist in the early part of the 20th century here in the United States, founded the Journal of Geology, flagship journal for many decades in geology. And T.C. Chamberlain developed a theory, what was really interesting in questions about the age of the Earth, the origin of the Earth, things like this. And T.C. Chamberlain was very upset about Lord Kelvin's vision of the Earth, not just because Lord Kelvin said the Earth was extremely young, which he said and turned out to be incorrect, but because Chamberlain thought that Kelvin's vision of the Earth was depressing. And he wrote this. He said, you know, Kelvin has this vision of the Earth that's based entirely on thermodynamics and the second law, and there's this heat death, and the Earth is decaying into a frigid, horrible, you know, frozen wasteland. And Chamberlain thought, this is incredibly depressing. And it's much too depressing, particularly to teach undergraduates. He actually wrote this. And he's trying to build a geology program at the University of Chicago, and he thought, there's nobody's going to become a geology major if we tell them how depressing it all is, right? And so he consciously looked for a problem, for a flaw in Kelvin's reasoning, because he wanted a more uplifting and optimistic vision of the Earth. Now, in hindsight, we would look back on that value. We look back on that motivation. We'd say, boy, that's not really right. I mean, we think that we do science where the chips fall where they may, and if it's depressing or if it's uplifting, oh, well, you know, life's tough, hard cheese, right? So we would look back on Chamberlain and say, yeah, you know. But the reality is that that value motivation led him into a whole domain of really interesting work, which actually helped prove that Kelvin was wrong. So that's a really interesting complication. It shows somebody can bring a set of values to the table that we might not agree with, and yet they could still be productive of accurate science. And so how do we make sense of that? And so what I would say, and I think most of my colleagues working in science studies today would say, what we've come to understand is that the robustness of scientific knowledge does not inhere in the moral qualities of the individual scientists. What it inheres in is the social process by which scientific knowledge is vetted. So it doesn't matter what my motivation is as an individual. I could be a Buddhist, I could be a Christian, I could be agnostic, I could be a right-to-lifer, I can be anything I want to be. And that might motivate why I work on what I work on, and it might even motivate not just what problems I choose to work on, but what methods and how I look at the data could motivate all kinds of things. But then I've got to bring my work to geophysical research letters. And it's got to stand the test of time. It has to be stood, not the test of time, but it has to stand the vetting of other people who don't share my values. And it's that process, it's the process of vetting by a community of experts who bring different values to the table. That is, I would argue, and I think most people in science studies say would argue, that's what makes the knowledge reliable and robust. It's the community structure. So this actually has a very important pedagogical implication, because often when we teach about science, particularly if we teach as scientists teaching science as opposed to as historians of science, we teach about the great heroes of science. We teach about Darwin or Einstein or, you know, Newton or whoever it is you love. And we perpetuate this notion of science being advanced by these great individual geniuses. And certainly the individual geniuses play a role. But from a social point of view, from a policy standpoint, from the question of why the community at large should accept the results published in NOAA's journal, the answer is it has nothing to do with whether or not the people submitting to NOAA's journal are objective or neutral or not value-laden or smart or dumb. It has to do with whether or not his journal is doing a good job of peer review. And if the peer review process is working as it should, and not just in his journal, but of course in all the different journals, then we have some reason to believe that the net result is going to be reliable, irrespective of what values people may bring to the table initially.
Great. And I mean, I think you've highlighted very nicely the positive role that values can play. But there's also the danger, of course, that values will somehow distort science. And you actually give many very interesting examples of this in your book. And the other side, of course, there's the news about the so-called ClimateGate scandal with the Climate Research Unit, and where at least some have argued that the objectivity or the idea of scientists as dispassionate investigator has been basically compromised by those emails. So I guess the question is, how do we guard against the potentially distorting effects of ideology and value in climate change research, or maybe even the appearance of...
Right. Well, okay, so two things. I mean, first of all, you refer to my book, so just to fill people in. So in Merchants of Doubt, we tell the story of a group of physicists who basically challenged accepted scientific evidence on a whole set of issues and took highly contrarian positions that went against what were considered to be accepted scientific conclusions by the majority of experts. But in the book, we try to be really clear about a really important point. At the end of the day, the problem with what these people did is not what motivated it. Although in the book, we're at great pains to try to understand what's motivating it because we think that's interesting. And we think that from a social and cultural point of view, it's very, very interesting to understand why all of these things happened. But at the end of the day, the problem with what they did was not that they were motivated by a free market ideology. The problem is that they didn't subject their claims to peer review. That they went outside the processes by which the scientific community judges claims and instead created their own Potemkin village, right, that made it seem like it was science, that made it look like science, but it really wasn't. And when other claims had been vetted through the peer review process and stood the test of scientific scrutiny, well, they ignored that and basically dismissed all of that and said, no, don't look at those people over there. Look at us over here, and pay attention to us, and listen to us. So in that sense, what they did was dishonest by pretending it was actually vetted science when it really wasn't. So one can criticize them on a moral and ethical ground for being dishonest, because dishonesty is generally considered to be morally problematic, but it's not because they had a political ideology, and that's a really important point, because Hansen's got an ideology, Lindzen's got an ideology, all these people have ideologies, although interestingly enough, about Hansen, of course, he's also reacting to what he sees as a failure of society to act on what he thinks is objective and neutral science, but that's a complication. But the point is, it's not the fact that a person has a motivation, which is the issue. The question is, what does it lead them to do?
Yeah, so like I said, I have some thoughts that are inspired by what Naomi's saying. I mean, I think that the point about peer review is really important, and I think it's critical that because it is this community review, that fundamentally getting the science right is what's more important. And that if I guess I'd put out on the table as an argument that if the motivation of a large group of people was not to get the science right, but was instead to have some policy outcome, then I think that would risk failure of the scientific review process. And so, for me individually, I guess to the extent that I'm willing to cop to having an ideology about all of this, it's that the science be as value-free as possible, as objective as possible, as skeptical as possible, as evidence-based as possible. Because I think that we need that confidence both for the individual work and for the peer review process. That being said, I think that the incentives are such that there's quite a bit of motivation to correct something that's been published and is deemed to be incorrect. And so I think that I've heard the argument that that people just aren't willing to go against the herd, and I think that basically puts the incentives backwards from reality. That to make a name for oneself in the scientific industry, upsetting the apple cart is certainly a much quicker way to get there than showing that you got in line with 1,000 other people and you were the 1,001st.
Right. And it's not just in science, it's also outside of science, right? If Richard Lindzen were to say tomorrow, I've thought about this again and I've come to the conclusion my colleagues are right, the IPCC is right. Well, actually it would be news only because it's Lindzen, right? Mm-hmm. But let's just say some other scientist just says, oh yeah, the IPCC is right. That's not news. But if a scientist comes along and says, oh, I disagree, you know, I have a completely different interpretation. Well, that gets picked up by the press because now there's a conflict, now there's a story. So there are all kinds of motivations, both within science and outside science, for people to be contrarian, to be questioning the established wisdom. And as Noah said, if you actually have data that suggests that what most people think is true actually might not be, you know, if you can show it, if you have the evidence, not just, if you're not just saying it, right, saying it's not what it's about, but if you actually have evidence, most people in the scientific community are pretty willing to look at that evidence. And, you know, if you can make a persuasive argument, you can become actually really famous, right?
Great. Yeah. So that's really, so I'd like to turn to another source of possible distortion in climate change research, which is money. I'd like to ask, how should we try to guard against the potential distorting effects of various funding sources and the kind of incentives that come along with that? And I'll turn to Noah first.
I think I should be wearing the logos of the National Science Foundation and the Department of Energy. And, I actually think that we as a scientific community have some conventions, some conventional practices that at the very least put us at a pretty high level for declaration of conflicts of interest, at least financial conflicts of interest. So, you know, when I give a seminar on my, I'm not required to, but on my cover slide, I have the logo of every one of my funding sources right on the cover slide with my name and my affiliations. In the acknowledgement section, when we submit manuscript, we include the funding sources for that work. And there are journals that require, actually, that you submit not only the funding sources, but even the grant numbers. So now I just submitted a paper recently where I actually had to go and dig up the grant numbers at the submission stage, not at the publication stage. So I think that we have some practices, at least, that at least make a first cut. Now, I suppose a person could just not declare. You know, they could have a financial source and not declare it. For me personally, I'm not comfortable accepting funding from some entity that would have a financial stake in the outcome, and I have been asked by companies that have financial stakes in the outcome of potential research to generate some research for them based on my previous findings, and I've always turned those down. So my fundings come from all from federal agencies and the World Bank, and you know there are others that maybe have different lines. I think at a minimum they should be declared, but I'm not convinced that simply declaring them is sufficient to remove the influence.
Yeah, I think that's a really complicated issue because the word distortion implies that we know what it should have been and that it somehow got altered by some force that distorted the shape of the thing. And of course, we don't know that because we don't know what the truth is because we're trying to set out to find it. I mean, in a way, this is the fundamental dilemma of philosophy of science, is that we'd like to believe that we know the truth when we see it, and therefore we'd like to believe that we could recognize distortions, but the reality is that we actually can't. And the funding is the obvious and simple thing to look at, but there's a lot of evidence to suggest that that's not only a crude filter, but maybe not even a good one. So, and that cuts both ways. So in biomedical research, this is a huge issue, and if you're serious about it, then you need to get some people from the medical school there, right? Because this is where this has really become an enormous issue, because we do know that there are some very, very serious problems going on today in the biomedical area. And Journal of American Medical Association, The Lancet, a whole group of these British Medical Journal, have all implemented non-disclosure agreements. And I think most people in the biomedical community would argue that they are woefully insufficient, that really, it's just has essentially no impact. Because what it's not addressing is a whole set of other practices, including non-disclosure agreements, where people promise that if the results are negative, they won't publish them. And because these are confidential non-disclosure agreements, we don't know, and we don't have any way of knowing. So there could be all kinds of results out there that have been suppressed. You know, there's some evidence from lawsuits where these things have come out. So we know this definitely happens. So this issue of suppressing negative results is a really big one, particularly for universities who could have policies to stop it, but most universities have not been willing to because they've been afraid of losing funding sources. There's also the issue of what I call epistemic affinities or epistemic positions. And I think this is the most important one from a philosophical standpoint. So I don't actually agree that if someone has a financial stake in the outcome, it's necessarily problematic. And actually, if we use that standard, I mean, it's great that you can do that, that you have alternatives, but the reality is that this university would shut down. I mean, this university would shut down if it refused all sort of funding from, and the Woods Institute that you're affiliated with and a whole lot of other places on this campus would not exist. They would cease to function tomorrow. So then you have to ask yourself, is that a desirable outcome? Would we like to see Stanford University shut down? Well, maybe some people would. Cal probably would. but I think a lot of us would probably say, no, we don't necessarily want that outcome. So there's got to be some kind of more nuanced interpretation of this problem, right? And so then you can begin to think about, okay, well, and I can go further. There are lots of good examples in the history of science and technology of people funding research in which they had a vested financial interest, but yet great things came out of it. I think of Irving Langmuir, who won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry doing work at General Electric, in the General Electric labs that was all about building better light bulbs and all kinds of other things. Pioneering work on thin films, big financial interest. Westinghouse, big research labs. DuPont, you know. I mean, there are all kinds of important scientific work that have been done in industrial laboratories and in academics funded by industrial laboratories. My own PhD work was partly funded by the mining company that I had worked for before I came, and they had an absolute vested interest in the results. So, and it had to do with exploration. And I still think that my PhD work was good work, right? Okay, so, and it's good to be able to say that because people don't expect that from a historian of science. In fact, I actually got money from Chevron as a graduate student, believe it or not. It's not the fact of money, in my opinion. It's more subtle than that. It's what agreements have you made in exchange for that money, and what assurances or agreements do you have that the data will be published and accepted no matter how they fall out. Right, this is the chips falling where they may. So when I was a graduate student, the agreement that I had with the mining company that helped sponsor my research was that I had the right to publish the research no matter what, no matter what the results were, whether they were good or bad or embarrassing or not embarrassing to my company. And I actually wrote that agreement in part because I had a pretty good idea that some of the things I was going to say actually were embarrassing to my company in a certain way, which is, doesn't matter for our purposes here. But there's lots of other good examples. So if we think particularly about the tobacco industry, which we have a lot of research on, I've done research, the problem with the tobacco industry is not that they funded research. The problem is that they only funded research that they thought would help them cast doubt upon the harms of tobacco. And if the research didn't support their claims, they would suppress it. And so that's the point, right? So we can have we have lots of examples of good industrial funding or good military funding or good funding from government agencies that have, you know, agencies, mission-oriented agencies. So long as those agencies are prepared to accept the results, no matter what those results are, then I think things are generally mostly pretty good. Mm-hmm. But if they're not, then we can get into whole areas where we know things can be very bad.
I just add a small thing. I mean, I think there's also a worry about the kind of informal incentives, right? So I don't know if you publish something that's embarrassing for Chevron, you know, if you're going to have an ongoing relationship with them, even if you have no agreements with them whatsoever, right, you know, will you really publish those embarrassing results if you're going to rely on them for future funding? And it's just something for us to think about. I don't know if you want to jump in on this.
Well, yes, it's interesting to me that the emphasis is focused on results that would be embarrassing for the funder. And my concern is actually much less about that, maybe because most of my results are, you know, get classified as that already if we're thinking about for the National Science Foundation. I'm sure it's very embarrassing. But my concern is actually much more that I need to be able to publish whatever my results are. Well,
that's what I meant. I was just using that as one example.
Well, it is one example. But the other example is that if I find that some part of the climate system is not sensitive to increasing greenhouse gas concentrations, I need to be able to publish that.
Of course.
And I need to be able to publish it. And I'll just make a personal statement. I don't know about the philosophy of it, but I need to be able to publish that free of the cloud of whether that result was paid for by a funding source that is interested in scientific results that suggest that increasing greenhouse gas concentrations don't alter the climate system. Right. And likewise for benefits of climate change, if a funding source is invested in a perception that they will benefit from climate change, then if I publish a result that suggests that they'll benefit from climate change, I need to be able to publish that without.
Right, but that's consistent with what I'm saying. So it's about the epistemic stance. Is your patron or sponsor prepared to really pretty much accept whatever results you have, what come what may, or not? So I've done a lot of work on Navy funding of oceanography in the Cold War. And to a person, if you talk to scientists who worked with the Navy, they'll tell you the Navy was a great sponsor of scientific research. And that's kind of an interesting thing for me as a historian, because I look at the landscape and I say, wow, you know, the Navy was a great funder of certain kinds of geophysical research, but actually they were a really lousy funder of certain kinds of biological research. I mean, the Navy was definitely interested in some things, not others. So how can all these people say what a great patron the Navy was? Well, two reasons. One, because obviously if you were getting money from the Navy, it meant they were interested in what you did. So obviously, almost by definition, the people I'm interviewing are the people who liked Navy funding because they got it, not the people who had to go become, you know, lawyers and doctors or whatever else they did. But in the end, because the bottom line is that the Navy wanted to know the truth about the oceans. And bad information wasn't going to be any good to the Navy, right? And so the Navy was prepared to hear what scientists had to tell them about a variety of different issues. Now, you can contrast that, say, with the tobacco industry, which did not have that position. So it's not about the money. It's about the epistemic position to the information. Is your epistemic stance essentially neutral, that whatever the result is, okay, let's hear it, let's find out? Or are you only going to be receptive to certain kinds of results and not others? So the National Science Foundation, we would like to believe, and hopefully it's true, doesn't really care, right? If you found some evidence that the climate system was not sensitive to greenhouse gases in some way, presumably your funders at NSF wouldn't have a problem with that.
They
were right, but
what
having to do with knowledge, related to knowledge, right. So I mean, that's I think really the issue. So it's a more subtle one than just about who's paying for it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. Great. I'd like to turn now to the final major topic briefly, which is the public communication and the public communication of climate change research. And I'd like to start with a quote from the New York Times in a recent article. And the quote is, polls say 97% of working climate scientists now see global warming as a serious risk. And Noah and I talked about this in our conversation. And the question I want to raise is, how should journalists, the first question I want to raise is, how should journalists be summarizing and talking about climate change? And actually, I'll start with Noah on this question.
So I guess I don't know where that statement came from.
I know the Times article.
Yeah. I think I know the study it came from, but I'm not sure.
Clouds are the last source of doubt, or something like that. I don't remember the exact.
Right, but who were they quoting when they said 97%?
There was no quote. It was not attributed.
It's just like a factoid.
I guess I would. I'm a climate scientist, and I can't answer the question whether or not climate change poses a serious risk without knowing what that statement is about. Right? I mean, there's a lot of value in that statement. What's serious? What does that mean? Risk? Risk of what? So I think that's getting back to the first question about advocacy, and I guess the second question about values. I think that in terms of public communication, I think I personally, as a scientist who gets federal funding, have a responsibility to communicate what I know when I'm asked, and to be clear about what the basis of that knowledge is, and to be clear about what I think does not have basis, what I think we don't know. I guess in reaction to that particular statement, that quote, I don't think we have a basis for making that statement.
And so how should journalists, instead of that quote, what would you have preferred for something in a short article in the New York Times, for example?
Well, I guess it depends on what's trying to be communicated. I think that it's probably true that 97% of climate scientists are highly confident in the evidence that global mean temperature is increasing and that anthropogenic emissions of greenhouse gases are the primary cause of that observed global warming.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's just an incredibly bad piece of reporting. I mean, to say that 97% of scientists say this, and you have no idea where that comes from, who said it, where's, I mean, because I mean, that sentence, that's just really lousy reporting, right?
Okay.
So I think, I mean, I agree with, no. I mean, what you'd want to know, first of all, is risk to whom, risk to what, right? I mean, if it was actually a group of biologists, you know, led by Terry, saying serious risk to marine ecosystems, and here's why, because the pH of the ocean is changing, and we know scientifically that those changes can affect, you know, the plankton at the base of the food chain, and here's the evidence. So that could be a legitimate scientific statement to say there's a serious risk to, you know, marine organisms, right? Or, you know, there's a serious risk to people living within 1 meter of sea level because the evidence is pretty clear that we can expect probably, you know, a meter, let's say a meter, I'm using that, it might be half a meter, I don't know what it is, but, you know, I mean, I know what different people have told me. But let's say, you know, 97% of scientists polled at the IPCC or whatever agree, 1 meter of risk, 1 meter of sea level is highly likely by the end of the 21st century. That means that 350 million people who live within 1 meter of sea level plus $7 trillion in infrastructure and priceless cultural monuments are at risk of being inundated by sea level rise. Then you're being clear about what you mean by risk.
Right.
So, you know, the problem there is that risk is a very big word. Mm-hmm. And so that sentence needs more predicate.
But,
you know,
but, does,
right?
But does the public have the attention span for all of the caveats and
but it's
and
not
nuance?
A caveat. It's not a caveat to say I'm talking about risk to people living within 1 meter of sea level. That's not a caveat. Mm. That's some additional information that makes the word risk have meaning in that context.
I see.
Right?
Okay. Do you want to?
Well, I think what's even more interesting potentially is the fixation on how many. What percentage of what community believes what? And I don't quite understand why the press, to make a generality, and some fraction of the public is fixated on, I don't mean you all, but you know, is fixated on what percentage of what community believes.
Well, we know why they've done that, though.
Well,
they've done that in part. I mean, in part because of my work and other people who have talked about the
right.
scientific consensus, right? So a bunch of us have talked about the scientific consensus, and then Richard Lindzen comes along and says, well, actually, I disagree, and I'm a scientist, so therefore that proves there's no consensus. So then in response to that, some people, you know, have said, okay, well, let's be more specific about what we mean by the consensus. And so, for example, Steve Schneider and others wrote a paper in which they, I believe they used the 97% figure in that. So that this may be a hash of that article. I mean, that was done by people here. So they claimed that 97% that consensus was actually 97%. So they put a number on it, mm-hmm. and these people are perhaps picking up on that.
Right.
But I agree with you. I think it's, I mean, it, whether it's 96%, whether it's 97%, whether it's 98% is kind of here nor there, right? It's more about being clear about what it is we think we know is happening and what that means. I mean, I think one of the mistakes that climate scientists make, and not just climate scientists, but all scientists who are involved in risk-related issues, is that it's often framed in the future tense. It's about the risk that will happen down the road. And one of the interesting things about climate change is that a lot of these things are happening now already. I mean,
right.
people have already demonstrated many changes already underway. And I think speaking a little bit more about things that are underway keeps you in that domain of your expertise, right, without having to speculate about risks and getting into the language of risk, serious, grave, which, as you say, are value judgments, because what's a serious risk to one person might not be a serious risk to someone else.
Right. And actually, to talk more about why this 97% is important, I think we need to turn to the questions of how the media portrays different sides of this argument and the question of balance and fairness. And then actually, I'd like to show a quick video clip of of a recent show in Australia about climate change research, or about climate change.
About half of all Australians don't believe climate change is man-made.
One thing that really pisses people like me off is this red herring that people like you raise, and it is part of the slander of the environmental movement.
While the other half believe the need for action is urgent.
We are the last line of defense for Mother Nature.
One of the things which I think has disconcerted a lot of people is the evangelical fervor of the climate change alarmists.
Climate change is real.
Is there a better way to resolve the conflict that's dividing our nation? We're taking environmental activist Anna Rose.
We've come together to release this statement calling for greater action on climate change. And we're calling for deep emission reduction targets.
And committed climate skeptic Nick Minchin.
One day the world will realize that carbon dioxide is more of a friend than an enemy.
Around the globe, to meet their pick and the world's leading voices on climate change.
Because ever in history has the CO2 levels been as high as they are now?
Not in the last million years. 111 countries galloped in a survey. The majority of the human race isn't afraid of global warming.
I'm not going to be engaging in quite too much debate because he is known for making things up.
There's a lot at stake. They'll be trying to change each other's mind on the most important questions of our time. Is climate change happening?
Okay.
Is this a Murdoch paper?
Yes.
So this is the reason I bring this example up is just to as an example of the kind of approach that journalists take to climate change. You have one person who's going to who's a climate environmental activist, and she's going to bring her experts, and you have another person who's a climate skeptic, and he's going to bring his experts, and basically there's going to be a kind of fair and balanced, maybe you want to call it, or balanced. I didn't mean to use that phrase. A balanced and fair discussion of climate change. I'm putting that in quotes. And the question is, how should in society, how should we approach the question of having this debate when you have a very large percentage of scientists thinking, you know, one thing and then a minority thinking another thing, or, you know, it's a general matter.
Well, you know, I slightly bashed the New York Times a minute ago because, you know, to say 97% believe this without a Tribune is pretty bad reporting. But obviously, you know, in their defense, right, the reason the New York Times is doing that is in response to this kind of, frankly, trash journalism, right? And this is a Murdoch paper, and this particular thing was produced by, well, the head of the Australian Broadcasting Commission is, like, best buddies with Rupert Murdoch. So there's a backstory there. But I mean, this has been a big issue in the journalistic community. I was just at a conference in Madison last month that was exactly on this topic about how to write science in the context of all this sort of thing. And so a lot of science journalists have recognized that the balance framework doesn't work effectively when you're talking about a technical issue in which there is a broad-scale agreement among technical experts. But they're up against this kind of thing. They're up against both journalistic norms of balance, that it's only fair to give both sides of the issue, and also a kind of pressure to make a story be interesting. And so if you have a conflict between opposing sides, then you immediately have a story. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you don't have a conflict, then it's not clear what your story is. So the New York Times has tried to answer this by saying, oh, 97% of scientists agree. So they feel that that's sort of their response, is to be clearer about the fact that the vast majority of scientists do agree, but then you end up with this sort of weird thing of, well, where'd they get that number from, right? Mm-hmm. So it's difficult. It's a difficult problem.
So I guess I can only speak from my experience. I actually got asked to speak at the Heartland conference, which started today. And goes tomorrow and then ends on Wednesday morning.
Me
and,
too. Actually, a lot of people got asked. Yeah.
Well, I thought I was the only one that had been asked.
Well,
but
there
it
you
turns
go.
Out I wasn't.
Sorry to, you know.
My point is, I agreed. I said, I'll sure. But I have this other panel that's on Monday night, and I've got some student exams, and so I physically actually can't be there on those 3 days that you happen to be having it. I offer to do a video. Conference. I was then told that they wouldn't be able to set up video capability, although I did find the live stream this morning for all of the from the venue, so there is video streaming. But I guess my point is that there is this sense that we can set up, you know, we'll have this side and then we'll have this side and we'll have a debate. And I don't, it's not clear what we're debating, right? So, and it's not even clear, scientists agree. We'll agree on what?
Right.
So, I mean, I often don't agree with the statements that are written that I read about what climate scientists agree on. I know I personally don't agree with.
You don't agree about the details? You don't agree about the way it's framed? Or you don't agree with the main argument?
Well, for something like 97% of climate scientists agree that climate change poses a serious risk, I really have no way of knowing if I agree with that
right,
or not.
But that's the New York Times saying it, right?
Right, so you can imagine all the other statements
right,
that are out there.
Right, right.
My point is just that I think that it's a contrived device to have this you know, point counterpoint kind of construction. If we have a question about what's the state of our knowledge about the world, then we know what our state of knowledge is. We can assess the literature, and different people might have different interpretations of the literature. But it's we can actually answer the question rather than have a debate about. It's not clear to me why it's relevant what percentage of people living in what countries are worried about climate change. I mean, it's relevant for a whole lot of policy and political science and other questions, but it's not relevant for whether or not climate change is occurring.
Right, but that's the point, though. That's the whole point of the strategy, is that they're trying to blur that distinction. Right, they're trying to say that because maybe half the people in Australia don't think climate change is serious, that somehow that casts doubt upon the science. And so this is part of a strategy, you know, which I've studied, to kind of muddy the waters and confuse people. And so the harder thing, which I was also invited to, and so were about 10 other people I know, you know, they want to pull people into a debate framework because they want to be able to argue that there is a scientific debate. And so that's why it's almost, if you get invited to one of these things, you're really stuck between a rock and a hard place. Because if you say no, it may seem as if you're closed-minded and unwilling to discuss important issues, and they'll say that. They'll say, oh, we invited, you know, all these wonderful people, you know, like Noah Diffenbaugh, and he wouldn't come. You know, scientists aren't willing to talk to the public on this issue. But if you do go, then now we have a debate, and so that proves there's a debate. So when I got the invitation, my invitation invited me to be part of a panel of warmists versus skeptics. So I thought about that one for a few minutes. I thought about saying I would be willing to come, but I'm not a warmist. I'm a historian. And if you're prepared to introduce me as a historian, I thought about that, but then I decided no. You know. And then the other thing is I said, I'm not prepared to be involved in a debate because, you know, there's nothing for me to debate. If you'd like, I'd be prepared to come and give a talk about how we can address climate change without undermining personal liberty and freedom. Because that, you know, as I talked about earlier today, I mean, that's what I think this is really about for a lot of people on the conservative side of the political spectrum in the United States. I mean, the Heartland Institute has a whole lot of reasons why they want people to think that the science isn't settled. And so there's a whole bunch of strategies that are being brought to bear, including what we just saw here. And it is very, very tricky to know how to respond to it. It's not an easy problem. You do want to speak to the public, you do want to participate, but you don't want to get sucked into a debate framework which actually confuses people about the evidence rather than informing them.
I'm going to now turn it over to the audience, but I do want to point out that it's interesting that in our judicial system, I mean, this is the way we often settle a lot of scientific, I mean...
scientific debates.
Well, but the jury has to decide what's going on, they have both sides bring expert witnesses and their questions. So there is this kind of, in our jury system at least, when scientific questions are before the jury, we do have this kind of debate where different sides are able to bring their experts and it's just sort of interesting to think about why that does work, why it doesn't work, et cetera. But anyway, I would like to open it now to the audience. And we have a microphone. Yeah, if that's okay, yeah. So if you raise your hand, just please, just a few things. Wait for the microphone so that we can get it on the videotape. Please keep the questions on the topics that we talked about today, if you can, short and ending with a question mark. Yeah. Yeah, you can point. Sure, you can point.
Is there a limit?
Introduce yourself first, sorry.
I'm Norm Sleep. I'm in the Department of Geophysics at Stanford. Is there a limit where the press ceases going on two sides? We had nobody on the clips yesterday seriously claiming the sun was being attacked by a dragon. Fox News is largely abandoned, saying the moon landing was fake. We don't get people even on Fox stations saying cigarettes are good for your lungs. And where is this reached and what controls it?
Great.
Oh, well, we're wired. You don't need to, yeah. Well, so this is a really important question, and I've raised this with journalists. I've said this. I said, look, when you have, you know, when there's an earthquake, we saw Fukushima, you didn't trot out, you know, people who advocated the expanding Earth theory to explain Fukushima, right? I mean, not Fukushima, but the earthquake that preceded it, right? So why would you trot out a skeptic about climate science? I mean, the reality is that there's no organized disinformation campaign about plate tectonics, and there is an organized disinformation about climate science. So that's a reality, and that makes it, that's a very difficult reality to deal with because, you know, as academics and scholars and scientists, we'd like to think we could just kind of relay our research results and they would be accepted by society and that would be great. But the reality is more complicated. And the fact is, it is true that they don't trot out people who say that tobacco is good for you anymore, but they did for an awfully long time. And I actually did a search on this to look at when was the last time that the New York Times quoted an expert saying that tobacco didn't harm you. Anyone want to guess?
1980s.
Very close, 1979, right. So this is fully, what, 20 years after the scientific evidence was pretty well established. So, you know, it takes, the press are a little slow.
do you want to talk?
I think the only reason to believe if you're not a scientist, the only reason to believe what a scientist says is that you have some faith in them individually, to the extent that you have experience with scientists, in the institutions of science. I mean, there's no, the volume of peer-reviewed information that's being produced now is, I'm sure someone's counted up the number of bites, but it's, yeah. just in the climate research community, it's impossible to assimilate. So, you know, I don't have the wish that I publish some paper and then everybody believes it because they just know that it's right. I mean, there's no way to know that it's right if you don't understand everything that is being said, right? Everything that's being written, if you don't understand the processes that at which it's arrived. So it requires a bit of faith regardless. And so I think that, you know, in my experience of running into this disinformation campaign is that it is targeted at creating that doubt about, in many cases, about the institutions of science, and I think that's probably traceable. That statement is traceable.
My name is Shelton Ehrlich. I'm what's called in the invitation general public. I'd like to know if I'm the only skeptic in attendance tonight.
Skeptical of what?
The risks of CO2. Am I the only skeptic here? No. Raise your hand. There's one more? Good.
Well, skeptical of the risks of CO2.
Yeah, you know.
Tell me more.
I have a question about the science. The physical temperatures being measured at weather stations seem to be often erroneous because of where the weather stations are placed, next to concrete buildings, etc. And a person who I trust in climate science, whose name is Fred Singer, talks about the data from satellites that don't demonstrate any increase in global temperature.
Yeah, so that the issue with the satellite record has been has been clarified in the peer-reviewed literature, and you can go to the papers in 2005. They were published late in 2005 in Science Magazine, and those corrections are documented. But this purported disagreement between the surface temperature records and the satellite temperature records has been solved for some time. And actually, it came down to a human error in the satellite retrieval algorithm. Naomi may or may not have something more to say about
it. No, I agree with that, but I think you might want to clarify what you mean by solved, because I think for the general public it might not be clear to them what you mean when you say it's solved.
So maybe, okay.
I don't want to give the impression that there are no outstanding scientific questions about climate, and I actually don't. Thanks for coming. Thanks for your question.
Bob Siegel. I first want to refer to a slide that Naomi showed before, and she gave a list of reasons why people don't believe in climate change, and I believe that that list can be broken down into two quite disparate sort of groups of things. One group is people who can't be convinced of the evidence. So I was talking to somebody the other day, and we were talking about climate change. He said, there is no climate change. I said, what data could possibly convince you? And he said, no data. So there's that group of people. Then there's the other group of people who basically know the data. And she gave some examples of, about heart disease, so you might keep smoking. But I think the most compelling example is bicycle helmets. So I've asked people, there's not a single student here that doesn't realize that bicycle helmets are dangerous. They're not addicted to not wearing bicycle helmets. They don't, they're not delicious. You know, so there's a whole list of reasons why behavior doesn't, knowledge doesn't equal behavior. So I think you have, in some sense, you have this sort of drive toward ignorance where nothing can convince them. And then you have people who actually are completely convinced that there's climate change but don't want to do anything about it. So I mean, how do you deal with those two disparate things? And I think we've been sort of mixing them together in a way that is somewhat unhelpful. I mean, and this was a good example of that.
Well, I just want to say one thing. I told my daughter yesterday that if she doesn't wear her bicycle helmet, I'm going to stop paying her Stanford tuition. So, so sometimes you have leverage, you know.
Can you
do climate change? Well, yeah, so I'm trying to think of what the climate change equivalent is.
Well, to me, and anyone can feel free to disagree with me and even to voice it. They're completely separate issues. The issue of whether or not climate change is occurring and whether or not further emissions of greenhouse gases will cause further climate change to occur is a separate question from whether anything should be done, what anything should be done, the distributional details of a policy, if a policy is deemed to be desirable. The question of doing something about it should have no bearing on observation of what's occurring, which is a direct observation, or about our understanding of the physics and chemistry and biology of the climate system that leads us to conclude what the response is likely to be if there are further increases in greenhouse gas concentration. So I think
No, but I think the point is, though, I mean, I agree exactly with what you said. The question of whether or not climate change is happening, the question of whether or not more greenhouse gases will lead to more climate change is a different question than what to do about it. But the problem is that, so you want to make a clear separation and say, I can do the scientific research, and that's separate from whether or not we should do anything about it. But that's, we have a lot of evidence that many people don't view it that way. That for many people, these things are tightly coupled. And if they don't like what the solution is, like they don't like bicycle helmets, I mean, to pursue your analogy, the analogy would be people who don't like bicycle helmets who would refuse to accept the scientific evidence that not wearing a helmet is dangerous. And in fact, that does happen. I don't know if it happens with bicycle helmets, but I do know that it's happening right now in field hockey with respect to the issue of wearing goggles. So Recently, the Field Hockey Association of America required girls playing field hockey to wear goggles. And there are all these people in the Field Hockey Association who are denying the scientific evidence of the safety of goggles. So this is like, this is a tremendously powerful thing that people do. And so in order to address that, you know, you need a kind of different toolkit to think about the cognitive and the psychological and the political dimensions that make people resist data that seems to imply certain kinds of actions that they don't want to take.
Hi, I'm Katie Mock with the IPCC Working Group Technical Support Unit. And I had a question about the separation between fact and value for climate change research that's focusing on the problem space, you know, the physical climate itself, the impacts of climate change, as opposed to research that's looking at the solution space. And I guess I'm wondering, do you see distinctions across those two spaces? For example, in the solution space, if you'll hear people say that when they're studying geoengineering strategies, that they're enabling that research or enabling that strategy is potentially a value judgment, or if you're studying adaptation and mitigation with linkages to sustainable development, are the theoretical underpinnings of your research harder to extricate the value judgment from the fact of the evidence?
Well, so I, I guess my work is relevant in that, as you've described the solution space. So I think for me what's important is to be clear about what's science to understand the way the world works, and what's advocacy of an outcome. So I don't know if I'm the only one for whom that's a clear solution for. But to me that's the way it works in my mind. I'm happy to tackle any problem scientifically, I think it's important that how I communicate about those results is about the science of what we understand about how the world works. And then the what to do about it, I'm not arguing that it's irrelevant for what to do about it or that it should be ignored, that the implications should be ignored, just that advocating for a particular outcome is something separate. And so, I personally agree with the IPCC description, as I understand it, of policy relevant but not policy prescriptive.
But there's a middle ground between those two things that you just said, which is also scientific evaluation of policy options, right? There are research programs that can look at certain proposed options and see what the likely outcomes
are.
And that's where there's a kind of gray zone, right? Because if you become involved in the scientific research and evaluating policy options, which the IPCC, in fact, does do.
So my most recent paper is on that.
Right, okay.
So I lump that in with doing science to understand world works, and how we manage our environment is part of how the world works.
Frankly, I
haven't been convinced that we understand the consequences of our various policies well enough to predict the consequences in advance. I think we need more science about that human dimension.
Yeah, I agree. It's completely. But just one other thing on the IPCC. I mean, this gets back to what I said earlier about IPCC being hybrid. I mean, certainly in Working Group 2 and 3, there's clearly a policy dimension, right? So much of that work is highly policy-oriented. And I think the IPCC has been a little bit, not always consistent on this issue, in my opinion. So, for example, I remember a few years ago hearing a scientist who was prominent in the IPCC giving the usual spiel about how it's policy-relevant but not policy-prescription. We don't recommend policy. We just kind of try to understand the world and lay out the options and this sort of thing. And that was all very well and good, and he was extremely articulate. But on the slide behind him was a picture of the cover of one of the IPCC reports. And I can't remember if it was the second or the third assessment report and whether it was Working Group 1, 2, or 3. But the photograph was a picture of a very nice-looking elderly couple riding bicycles in front of a windmill. To most people, that would send a certain kind of message about what sorts of policy solutions you might be sympathetic to. And the fact that they would use that cover, you know, to me says that there's a certain not fully thinking through on all levels some of these interesting complications about the boundaries between the science and the policy.
I have a question about the 3%. That is, the scientists who are not supporting the idea of there being a human component to climate change. And if it's not money, if it's not ideology that's motivating this 3%, then what is it? And are they putting out any evidence? And it's interesting to me, what is the nature of that evidence versus the evidence that the 97% accept? So what is going on with the 3%?
Well, I think we don't really know what that 3% number is. I know that in my own research, right, in my own research, when I looked at this question, I tried to be specific about what it was I was saying scientists were agreeing about. And so I took a particular phrase out of the National Academy of Sciences review of the IPCC that was done in response to the Bush administration. So the Bush administration asked the Academy the question, do American scientists agree with the IPCC claim that most of the observed warming over the past 50 years is likely to have been due to the increase in greenhouse gas concentrations? And that came out of the third assessment report of the IPCC. So when I did this work, I tried to be extremely clear about what exactly I was saying are scientists in agreement. And that was the box that I wrote on an index card and, you know, put above my desk and gave out to the student research assistants who helped me out. And so the question we said was, how many articles published in peer-reviewed scientific journals disagree with this statement, either by presenting empirical data or a theoretical argument or modeling results that provide evidence that is not consistent with this claim? And in our sample, which was, I forget the number, 970-something articles, we didn't find any. And so that was the result that we published in Science Magazine in a peer-reviewed scientific journal back in, when did I publish that, 2004? I don't know, something like that. Okay, so I don't know what that 3% number represents. But certainly there are people who are motivated by ideology. There are people who are motivated by money. They may be in that 3%. I mean, unless we actually looked at that in more detail and looked at who those people were. But they may just have different opinions. I mean, in any scientific community, there are always some people who just have a different view. And as a historian of science, my view is that that's fine. You know, it's not really a problem. There are people who don't believe in plate tectonics. There are very credible physicists who don't accept quantum mechanics, who still pursue hidden variable theories. Einstein never accepted quantum mechanics. Sir Harold Jeffreys never accepted plate tectonics. There are people who don't think that DNA carries hereditary information. You know, that's okay, right? I don't actually think that's a problem. The question is, what do we base our public policy on? And if we believe that there's overwhelming empirical evidence that's consistent with the laws of physics and consistent with the evidence from climate modeling, and there's a consilience of evidence and all of the data that we have from satellites, it's a shame that he didn't stay to hear more about the satellite data, but I mean, the satellite data, the ground data, the modeling, the basic physics, I mean, if these things all align, and the vast majority of scientists, whether it's 95, 97, 99, it doesn't really matter, agree with it, then to me that says we probably have a pretty robust basis for thinking about public policy.
I think this is as a quick note, I'm gonna be a stickler for words, and but I think it's really important. There are a lot of scientists in the world. If we're talking about scientists, that's a big population. And frankly, I mean, how many scientific papers are published every day? I have personally no basis for evaluating the content of the vast majority of scientific papers that are published every day. Right? So it's really important if we're saying climate scientists are scientists, and there are people who present data that are sloppy about how they use those words. I mean, the population of scientists in the world is a very different population than the population of scientists who are publishing the papers that Naomi evaluated. Right? That's a much smaller subset of the world community.
For people who are publishing in this field, the work that's done is picked up a lot, or has extreme relevance to policy, and is looked at a lot by people who may or may not fully, go through all of the arguments and all of these assumptions and everything, but have a huge amount of power in how that science is used. I think we could probably all think of instances where there are beautiful sensitivities done to assume parameters and things like that, that were just ignored in the final report. And so do you think that there is, that scientists should change the way that they craft their reports if, given knowledge that that report might be very important or you know, given knowledge about the audience, or is this, you know, science is science?
So I can answer for myself as someone who's in that position. So I mentioned this most recent paper that actually did evaluate the U.S. biofuels mandate and its interactions with climate variability and change. And that paper, there were quotes in response to that paper from both Iowa senators, one of whom was attributed to saying that he had seen the report. Whether or not that's true, I'm not in a position to say. But the point is that, yeah, I mean, we publish a paper in a journal, and then by whatever means, it ends up getting commented on by an elected official. You get asked, speak for myself, you get asked to talk to staffers, get talked to elected officials. So I guess I would say science, and that's our scientific communication with our peers. And then I think that my approach is I always say yes if it's it might be the might be an event like this that I'm saying yes to. It might be the Heartland Institute that I'm saying yes to. It might be the New York Times. It might be something else. But I feel like I have a responsibility to communicate as best I can when asked. But I'm personally, I'm not willing to alter the science that I'm either doing or how I'm communicating it within that context.
So I have a slightly different view. So you said something about policy people reading scientific papers, but the reality is the vast majority of people in position don't read the science. They might read something that their staffer summarizes for them, or they might read the summary for policymakers of the IPCC, or they might read the executive summary of a National Academy panel. I mean, policy people rely on assessments and other digestions of the scientific literature. They don't actually read the scientific literature. And so I actually have a new research project looking at scientific assessments that's about exactly this question, about how do scientists summarize, assess, digest data in these formats that are explicitly supposed to be to communicate to policymakers. And there, I think, I do think scientists actually do have to communicate differently. I don't think they have to change the science. I would never advocate that. But I think that the norms of communication, the way you craft your message, just like if you're a professor and you're lecturing to freshmen, you wouldn't talk to your freshmen in exactly the same way as you would talk to your graduate students in a graduate seminar. And you wouldn't talk to any of your students probably in exactly the same way you'd speak or write in a peer-reviewed scientific journal. We all know that in different venues, different ways of communicating can be appropriate depending on who your audience is. So I do think when scientists are involved in assessment work, that the question of audience is relevant, and that there may be ways and means of communicating that are different than what you would do if you were talking to a community of your peers. And it doesn't mean that you don't tell the truth about the science. Of course you do. But it means you may have to find slightly different ways of framing the discussion in order to reach the audience you're trying to reach.
Well, I was just going to say, I'm glad Naomi clarified for me why my freshmen don't understand me.
Okay, there you go.
My sense of the question was that it was about whether or not we should change the science, that the papers that we're submitting.
I was more talking about the way that the results are.
Yeah, so I mean, I agree completely. I think you talk to whoever you're talking to in a way that hopefully the truth can be understood.
We'll take one last question over there, and then I'll just have a quick thank you.
Naomi, I hope you'll let me challenge something that you...
Sure, you're a philosopher. That's your job, right?
Okay. Naomi, I hope you'll let me challenge something. You tried to tie up neatly before, but I'm going to try to open up the package and make a mess again.
Okay.
You were indicating, I hope I'm not misrepresenting what you said, that any kind of research is permissible so long as the results, no matter what they turn out to be, are published. And surely you can't...
Okay, I didn't quite say that, but okay, that wasn't quite what I said, but okay, you can go for a little while.
So the point I'm going to press is that, that can't be true. I mean, it's obviously we're not going to permit a research project that shows how best to torture children, even though those of us who have been
some
parents
might,
have fantasized about such a project at some points in our parenting careers. But more to the point, moral philosophers such as Steve Gardner have pointed out that research projects in geoengineering, the very undertaking of those projects and the institutions that support them, have some great moral dimension, and that the choice to actually undertake such projects has a bunch of values associated with it that can be and probably should be vigorously challenged. And so I'm not sure if we can leave it at you can do any research you choose so long as you publish the results.
No, absolutely. Okay. So I'm glad you raised this point so I could clarify. I did not at all intend to say, and if I did say it, I misspoke or didn't speak clearly. I did not at all intend to imply that all research is always fine and acceptable under all circumstances as long as it's open, as long as we can publish results. That's not what I meant. I absolutely agree with Steve Gardner and many other moral philosophers that there could be many reasons why either you as an individual or an institution might decide not to pursue certain forms of research. I mean, this is sort of a different question we didn't pursue today, which is sort of the ethics of research in general, like what areas of research you might decide on moral, ethical, political, or whatever grounds you might not want to pursue. I certainly think that that's an important area of discussion. What I meant to say was that the fact of who's funding it alone should not be disqualifying. So I think that there could be circumstances under which it could be acceptable. Well, okay, let me say the following. The tobacco industry case is an interesting case in point, because I do think that the vast majority of potential funding sources should be on the table as potentially legitimate so long as appropriate safeguards, disclosure agreements are in place. But at the same time, you might decide that there are certain funding sources that you simply would not take money from no matter what, even if it was you had all these safeguards in place. And this issue came up both here and at the University of California about the tobacco industry. Well, what if the tobacco industry did agree to full disclosure agreements? And I think that there's an argument to be made that tobacco industry money should not be accepted no matter what, because the tobacco industry was convicted of criminal conspiracy to defraud the American people by the U.S. Department of Justice. They were convicted under the RICO statutes, which essentially said that they operated like organized crime. And I think there's good reasons why a university like Stanford or the University of California, San Diego, might decide that for a variety of reasons, we should really not be in the business of accepting funding from organized crime or convicted criminals of various kinds. But even then, it gets complicated. Michael Milken now gives a lot of money for biomedical research. He was convicted of a crime that involved fraud and deception. So you might say no university should take money from him, but then he says, his response is, well, I served my debt to society, I went to jail, I paid my dues, and now I'm trying to make good by actually doing good in the world. You know, so again, a moral philosopher might take some time to unpack that one, and maybe would say, well, in Milken's case, he admitted he did wrong, he paid his dues to society. The tobacco industry today, we know, continues the same fraudulent, deceptive behavior for which they were convicted. Even in the face of conviction, they continue to do these things, so therefore that might be a reason not to want to be sponsored by them. So I think it's a complicated question, but I simply was trying to say on the funding issue, it's not simply a matter of, it's not a simple yes or no question. Yes, and if you are interested in this issue, you should read Robert Proctor's book. I already plugged it this morning, but I'll plug it again. Golden Holocaust by Robert Proctor, who's on the faculty here in history, gets into some really interesting details about some of these questions.
I know I'll give you the final word before I just, if you want to say anything about this, or if you just want to say something.
About anything.
I guess I'm not a moral philosopher or any other kind of philosopher, so. I guess I'm trying to deal with what comes at me. And that sometimes that's from peer reviewers, sometimes it's from the media, sometimes it's from entrenched financial interests. And so I guess I'm more comfortable having a clear-cut personal policy than parsing what's different about the tobacco industry from the energy industry or some other industry.
Great. And with that, I wanted to thank you all for coming, and especially thank our two panelists, Noah Diffenbaugh. And Naomi Oreskes. And I just wanted to say that Naomi will be speaking again next Thursday, not this Thursday.
Correct, a week.
Not this Thursday, but a week from this Thursday at 4:15 at the
History Department.
At the History Department, and she's going to be talking about the crucial experiment. There's a subtitle.
The crucial experiment that wasn't.
That wasn't.